I'm Steve Saranovic, and I'll be moderating this session and keeping it under control. And we're going to limit it to, like you said, three questions, but we'll ask all of you to make the questions brief so that we have time for answers and not to go into long speeches or concerns that you might have. Motivate the question quickly and get to questions. But before we take three questions, I'm going to take my privilege of asking a couple to get us started. And the two questions I have for both of you are, first of all, has to do with the timing of protection. So if new orders come forward quickly, how quickly could tariffs rise up in the industries that are targeted? I know that the tariffs will be raised before the final investigations are completed, and so protection can be implemented in a fairly quick way, but I'd like to get some sense of how quickly that would be if more cases come through, and then also about the administrative capacity to kind of handle if there is a surge of cases. And Matt, you were talking about there being quite a few more in the last few years, but if there's a doubling of that, for example, is it administratively possible to process these rather quickly? So that's the first question. The second question, the second question has to do with the potential for retaliation. So I'd like both of you to comment a little bit about the processes in other countries, the use of trade remedy cases amongst other countries, and what the potential would be and the timeliness. How quickly could other countries respond in a retaliatory way if they're suddenly faced with high tariffs?
Should I go first?
Please.
Okay. So on timing, it depends a little bit on the type of case you brought. If you're talking about traditional dumping and countervailing duty cases, the law prescribes for set time frames to get the preliminary determinations out, and that's the first indication where you can impose what we call deposits on somebody. So if a dumping case gets brought and you go through to the preliminary determination and they decide there's a 15% dumping margin, then immediately deposits get posted and entries are what we call suspended, so that you have to put these deposits into an account from then on, whenever you bring product into the country, and then they adjudicate later whether you actually owe the money, the final decision about whether. But the money starts going in at that point. The Commerce Department normally do that in about, we're talking about 3, 6, 9, 12, about a little over 4 months they have to do their preliminary determination period, a little bit more than that. But normally in the past, they would extend these things out. And a preliminary determination can be extended out several months if it's considered, if the petitioner asked it to be or the Commerce Department says it's a complicated case. And up until this year, we've almost always had these cases extended out because they are more complicated than people usually think they are, except right now. I actually have a case that we're going in right now, and I just spent the afternoon yesterday over at the Commerce Department arguing with them that they were not going to extend out the preliminary determination. And there is a sense now that the government is telling people to Commerce Department to try not to extend these cases, which means the decisions are going to come faster. They're going to be putting compensatory duties in place quicker, and so the effect will be accelerated as long as that continues on. And it puts a huge burden on respondents because the amount of material that you have to put in to respond to an investigation these days is a quantum leap over what it used to be because of our ability to mine data electronically now. I said jokingly to the Commerce Department yesterday, 15 years ago, if I put a submission in, it would probably be maybe, you know, a couple hundred pages long with exhibits, 15 exhibits, 100 pages total. In the case that I'm doing right now, we have put 2,000 pages of responses in place, over 200 exhibits, and about 80% of them are detailed spreadsheets and pivot tables that reconcile back to electronic financial information in the company's systems. That's the level of detail you have to give in these cases. That can't be done in 3.5 months. Normally, but that's the time schedule we're on. Same thing goes with a safeguards case. There are specific time zones they have to be, and you know the time periods they have are statutory maximums, not minimums. So if the government wanted to, it could say start a 201 today, safeguards case. Well, normally we have 4 months to make a decision. Oh, let's do it in one. Right now, whether that's defensible is another matter, but they could try.
I don't really
Let me. I'm going to defer to other questions. I think Matt has covered. On the foreign. Well, you know, the one that I'm particularly aware of, the Chinese sometimes oddly quickly have anti-dumping cases against sensitive U.S. products when they are irritated about something or the other. And, you know, one of the hopes might be that foreign reaction to any of these cases would be the break on this, that U.S. export interests could be affected so that might alter the behavior. But I think it could be, the retaliation could be pretty quick. The other countries do not have as a legalistic of a process as we do, you know, one that is as subject to court, to a transparent process. It's a little bit more of a black box. And that's subject to more political manipulation. So I think you probably see cases pretty fast.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And it is true that the Chinese do have a tendency to bring cases very quickly after we've come up with a determination that is considered unfair in their eyes or adverse. I will also say that historically retaliation has been less on the table because we were the game in town. We were the big consumer market. We were the market everybody wants to be in, right? So the Mexicans historically would say, well, we don't want to, you know, upset the United States because it's a big consumption market for us. So maybe we'll take a little of this heat, right, and absorb it. Or a lot of countries. Well, that game is changing rapidly now. It is not the U.S. is the only game in town anymore. That, to me, increases the risk of retaliation taking place, which makes this a much more dangerous game than it was 15 years ago.
Okay, let's open up for some questions. We'll take three at a time, have some hands up, and wait for a microphone to come. Let's go right there.
One, two. Hi, I'm Michael Anderson, U.S. International Trade Commission, Office of Investigations. I just in phrasing my question here about increased cases, you mentioned Mr. Nolan, 2012, we started to see the increase. And this past year at the Trade Commission, we had a 15-year high of the number of cases we processed and completed. And speaking of a lot of firms out there, a lot of it is just driven by the competition in the U.S., the global economy, and particular industries where commodity prices have dropped drastically in the last couple of years. But my question for you is, the weekend of the inauguration, President Trump put a hiring freeze on government agencies, and you're talking about these self-initiated cases, and you're talking about the speed of those decisions. How do you think that's going to play out for agencies like the Department of Commerce and the International Trade Commission if resources or budgets are constrained under this administration? And in the as a practitioner and in a trade bar, how do you see that playing out, and what can agencies do with that situation?
Well, I mean,
hang on.
Oh, sorry. Go ahead. Yeah, right.
Question right here. Yeah, right here.
Chad Bound, Peterson Institute. Two quick ones. So historically, we know steel has been a big petitioner, but I think a lot of the industry right now is already covered by orders in place or that will likely soon be in place. So if we're going to see a lot more cases, what industries do we think they're going to come from, if not steel? And the second is, as bad as this stuff is, in the scope of the other things that we're going to talk about today, you know, potential withdrawal from NAFTA, 35-45% tariffs across the board on trading partners, typically, we also hear about these types of trade remedy cases as an escape clause type of argument. So how would you react to that, and how would you sort of petition what we might see relative to the other potentially horribly protectionist things that we might see as an alternative?
Right there.
Charles Bloom, IES Group. I have about as much experience as Michael in looking at the trade remedies, and particularly with steel. Over the time that you've looked at the industry, imports have ranged between, let's say, 20, round number, 20 and 40 million tons. They're not going down, despite all the many, many cases, Matt, that you complain about. So what's happened? I think we are looking at this only from the U.S. perspective. From the foreign perspective, the more competitive producers, as in Europe, they've given up their subsidies. They avoid most dumping cases now. What's wrong? The question is, what's wrong with steering our imports toward the fair traders and punishing the unfair traders?
Okay, Matt or Mike? wants to start? That's the end of three questions.
That's three. You want to start?
Oh.
Want to start?
Oh, I was thinking three people, but
this is like Monty Python. Three questions, please.
Well, on Chad's first question about my guess is that that steel has still some room to grow. Safeguards can be in place even when anti-dumping cases are in place. So you can still file a safeguard. You know, there's no restrictions on that. There have been anti-dumping cases always on steel, even during periods of these special arrangements. So if the industry wants it, I think they could probably get it. So I wouldn't rule that out. Matt might be a better person to address the which industries might also be interested in going at this. I mean, there is anti-dumping, or the trade remedies generally have affected a relatively small amount of U.S. trade in the past. I mean, this is one of the things that is encouraging about it. It's because of the way the laws are interpreted. There's very much a process that is required to go through, and I think it's a pretty there's discretion. I may complain about certain aspects of it, but it's a fairly predictable process that's subject to court review, and I think we do generally a pretty good job of it. Whether or not there might be an open door for other industries to look at possible complaints, I have my doubts that we won't see more. Mm-hmm. Which particular industry I would defer to Matt on.
Yeah.
Why don't we just import from the fair traders? I mean, I guess it all depends on what you mean by fair. I mean, the U.S. law has a particular set of circumstances that they look at of whether or not you're dumping. Frankly, it's pricing behavior that would be perfectly fine for a domestic industry that is deemed to be unfair by law, by international agreement. I fully understand that. But I'm not sure that some of the aggressive pricing is not just aggressive pricing and not predatory pricing. As an economist, I tend to think I worry about predatory pricing when you're trying to drive domestic firms out of business. I know that's not what the law is about. I understand that. It's about individual price transactions that you compare to another country's individual price transactions. To me, different price prices in different countries is not an evidence of unfair trade. It's different conditions in different markets. But I'm an economist. And it's not my job at risk. So I understand that. I understand that. But I think some of the unfair traders are people that just are operating in a normal business fashion. But that's an economist.
So let me try to take these. So I'll start with Mike's question. You guys are going to be in a world of hurt if this goes the way it might. Yes, you are right. There's a hiring freeze. There's a resource constraint. Secretary Ross has indicated that he's going to divert resources from other sections of the Commerce Department into the enforcement unit. I don't know exactly how that's going to work. None of us really does. But clearly, he has a much bigger agency to work with and the ability to shift resources around more from NOAA or from some other functions, some of which at the Commerce Department, you could argue whether they're more or less important to the economy going forward. The International Trade Commission, however, has absolutely one set of functions, and that's, two sets, the trade remedies and, of course, the 337 docket, which is the administrative law judges. That is what you guys do every day, all the time. Whether you're going to be able to continue to process these cases given existing budgetary constraints, I think that's a real big question for you guys, and whether they're going to give you more authority to hire more investigators, economists, research specialists to do the work. Because in the end, if you can't do it, then we have less information available upon which to rely in defending or bringing these cases. We rely heavily on the staff reports. You guys generate staff reports. We dissect those like nobody's business and try to find weaknesses in their cases. That means we would have to do more of it or try to, which is very difficult because that's all data, very driven, industry-driven data. Often it's not public. Can't find it. So, yeah, that's going to be a problem. Unless they go with the nuclear options, I mean, suppose we go off of the piecemeal dumping and go to 201 land. Suppose we look at negotiating voluntary restraint agreements again, which haven't been in place since the Reagan administration. I'm not surprised that our U.S. Trade Representative was Reagan's person who went out and negotiated the VRAs the last time around. Would it surprise me that we don't go back to that? Quite possible. I'm not saying it's going to happen, but that's the experience we have, and history is a good teacher about what's going or likely to happen in the future. Steele, what's going on? What's going to new petitions? As Mike said, this is like when you bring piecemeal protection cases, dumping cases, it's like pushing on a balloon. You can push this balloon here, and imports from the subject countries will go down. But they're not the only countries that make the product. So if you put duties on 7 or 8 countries that make hot-rolled steel, there are also 25 other countries that make hot-rolled steel that are not under that order. So what have you done? You've just caused the trade patterns to shift. So, for example, Turkey wasn't named in the latest hot-rolled case that got decided. But they don't make corrosion-resistant steel. Well, they are starting to make corrosion-resistant steel now. So your problem is when you bring it against one country, steel is a worldwide production phenomenon. So it's really hard to control it in that piecemeal fashion because over time, the trade will shift. And the only way you can do that is to bring a much larger form of control in place. That then takes me back to what I just said about VRAs and that sort of thing, because that's the only way you can control it on a large basis. And even then, to me, it's somewhat ephemeral because it's a very temporal phenomenon trying to control these things. New cases will continue to come for those countries that are not currently under order but make the same products. New cases will come on downstream products. So if you bring a case on hot rolled coil, okay, what do you make that out of? Well, you make pipe. Okay, that's under order. You make cold roll. That's under order. Corrosion resistant. That's under order. You make manufactured products. Those aren't under order. So the second you put a dumping order on a product, that product has an upstream and a downstream component to it. Something is being made out of something, and it's being made into something. That product's under order. This isn't, and this isn't. What are you going to do? Those products are going to start to increase, and then you'll have cases on those products. And this is a never-ending cycle, unless you put everything under order, and that's called a 35% border adjustment tax. Don't talk about that.
You get paid by the hour, don't you?
I get paid by the hour. And why aren't imports going down? For the same reason, because trade patterns shift. And we can debate whether trade is fair or unfair in various contexts. I have had clients where I have told them, you guys got a problem, you're subsidized. There's no question about it. We're just going to have to deal with that. You got to figure a way to stop doing it, or we're going to have a problem. Or you guys actually are engaging in pricing, which is not correct. You're selling in the U.S. at a lower price than you're selling in your home market. By definition, you're dumping. My problem is the system is looking for ways to find dumping when it doesn't really exist. And if you're going to do that, that's not the way the system is supposed to work. It's supposed to be neutral. It's supposed to find it if it exists, not create it. And I can give you very specific examples where adjustments were either denied, removed, or changed by the department in order to create dumping, in my mind, where the pricing was right, the U.S. prices were above the home market prices, they weren't selling below cost of production, and the only way you could find it is to make a technical change in the way you calculate something, and all of a sudden you get a 2.5% margin. And I've seen it happen. So to me, politics infuses this to some extent, and that's inevitable. It's always infused it to some extent. So I'm a respondents' counsel. I have a view on this.
Let's take a few more questions. Right here, who's got the microphone?
Tom Prusher from Rutgers University. Let me make two comments. One is on retaliation. I think the question of retaliation, we should think broader. It goes beyond simply trade retaliation, which is China is the most obvious. You know, the level of cooperation that's needed for instance, drug enforcement would be an example. If countries are mad at the United States relating to trade action, there might be other forms at which they can exert a burden on the United States that's not directly measurable by trade. And then second, on the question of why not just buy from the Europeans, I think there's a question of the trade law is the law designed to benefit foreign affiliates of U.S. Steel and ArcelorMittal, which is largely Europe, versus Korean firms and the Japanese, which are largely not affiliated with U.S. firms. So I would actually argue, we could argue for kind of standard most favored nation benefits of trade. We should just have an across-the-board tariff if we think there's a problem with steel. That would change the tilt the playing field away from preferring ArcelorMittal's affiliates and U.S. Steel's affiliates at the expense of the Koreans and the Japanese, which probably have duties that exceed a reasonable person's view of the extent of the unfair pricing that's happening with those firms.
Hi, guys. Jeff Horwitz, U.S. International Trade Commission. Somehow I didn't end up sitting with all of my coworkers on the other side of the room. This question's mostly for Matt, but Professor Moore, Professor Sternick, you know, I'll never turn down your opinions on something. Matt, slide 9, I believe, I won't make you go back to it, you were talking about what you see as sort of potential areas of concern, and one of the bullets said not accepting data corrections or something to that effect. I'm paraphrasing. You just probably alluded to it, but I think I want to hear a little bit more about it. With everything going on, like the media the last couple of weeks, if you're implying that we're entering a realm where facts and correct data aren't necessarily a requirement for some of these cases, that just seems like a really quick, a really dangerous area to be going in. So are you talking about the agencies, mine and DOC, with that, or are you talking about inabilities to accept like corrections from petitioning firms or defendants in these cases? What exactly are you talking about?
Let's go one more. Give you 2 minutes each.
Hi, Lynn Fisher Fox. Until 2 weeks ago, I was at Commerce Department. So I have about 3 questions, but I'm just going to ask one. On self-initiation, I hear a lot of folks proposing that that'll be a way to bring new cases or bring new cases faster. But I guess the question I have is, what does that really mean? What's saved? What's made faster by self-initiation? Does it eliminate a need for a finding that there's enough injury evidence to initiate a case at the ITC? Who has to pull that together? What choices does an administration have to make that they're going to self-initiate for industry A and not industry B? How will they assess which industry gets that favored treatment and which doesn't? I think there's a lot of questions that get bundled up in self-initiation that once you start to go down that path, and maybe you can tell that maybe I've started to go down that path in my prior position, you quickly come up against really good reasons not to do it except in the very special circumstances that we've seen in the past, like the end of a softwood lumber agreement or something like that.
I think this question is really more directed to Matt, but I would say on the dumping margins, the adverse facts available, when you make it difficult for respondents to provide data, they get to use potentially the allegations of the domestic industry. If you make the process difficult, you can get very high margins. China is still, is my understanding, still subject to non-market economy procedures so that they can get very high margins. Ignoring Chinese data necessarily, but there are ways in which these margins can really be much, much higher with the discretion of the Department of Commerce. And as Matt has said, that's a more, although it's subject to court review, it's a more political shop. And they've got discretion about setting those margins quite high to potentially eliminate some sources of a product. And that's problematic.
So on the retaliation question, I agree with you wholeheartedly. It's not just about trade. I mean, we have a lot of investment in places like China. Foreign exchange controls, capital repatriation, expropriation. You can make up a long list of potential ways where people could make their lives difficult, not giving visas to foreign business visitors. Hey, guess what we just did to Muslim countries like a week ago, right? Making it very impossible for them to come into the United States. That type of tactic could be reduplicated in any number of contexts with any number of countries, depending on what you want to do. So it is a dangerous thing. And I will say, there has been a change over the last 20 years, and you picked your finger on it, with multinationals. It used to be a really simple equation. It's us versus them, U.S. industry versus foreign industry. But that's gotten a lot muddier over the years, right? Because an ArcelorMittal will have facilities in seven countries. And then you start thinking, they start thinking strategically, well, we don't want to bring it against that country, and that country, because we manufacture in those places, and we want that material to feed our finishing mill in the United States or someplace else. On the other hand, we don't like that country, and that country, because they're competing with us. And so is the goal here to control unfair trade, or is it a way to control trade from your competitors and a form of harassment? You could argue that there's been some evidence to support that thought, that concept. On the idea of corrections, and that goes with adverse facts available in some contexts too. On the commission side, less so, other than the fact that when you get into the trenches and you're in an injury investigation, things are running fast and furious towards the end, right? At the beginning, at the preliminary, there's no time to really judge things, and the data is whatever it is at that point, and it's rough. At the final investigation, you know, once you kind of get into the final trenches, there are things that start showing up, anomalies in the data, and we all argue over those anomalies. And some of the anomalies could be arguably the way data is being presented by a party, either importer or U.S. producer. And so that can become a factor, and we rely more on the commission staff to go after that. And I'll have lots of conversations with the investigators saying, you guys, can you look at that, please? Then that works pretty well. The other side of the coin, and I hate to go after the Commerce Department because somebody's here from the Commerce Department, you guys get mad at me. I have a case right now where the Commerce Department, at a preliminary determination, said to us that the adjustment you claimed on a particular price adjustment you claimed, we're not going to grant to you because some of the supporting documents that you put in an exhibit, we couldn't read fully. And because of that, we're denying the entire adjustment, even though those documents are literally just physical supporting documents to a spreadsheet, which actually has the full context of the adjustment. And we didn't bother to tell you before the preliminary to resubmit those in a more legible fashion. We just decided that we're not going to give you the adjustment and said, well, what about giving us a chance to make it up at the verification says, no, we're not going to verify it because the data is not on the record for us to verify because we rejected the submission because we couldn't read three or four of the pages in it. That is now under appeal. Okay? But that's the sort of thing you get into, and what it's causing us as practitioners to do is now I am fly-specking submissions much more carefully about is everything uploading into Access in a legible fashion. And I actually am putting statements in our submissions now that if you can't read any of this, please contact us immediately for resubmission so we have the opportunity to cure. Because I can't tell sometimes if a submission gets fuzzed up. I mean, look, Access is a great electronic system, except we bought the cheapest thing that the GAO would buy, which means it's not exactly perfect. And I've seen enough instances where things we put on the record, oh, my God, I can't read that. Right? And so what we're doing now is every Excel spreadsheet is being put in a native format, being submitted to the department along with the PDF copies. Everything's being uploaded in a fashion so that we have better control over that. I'm just disappointed that it was, to me, used as an excuse not to. And adverse facts or facts available is being used much more frequently now than it has in the past. And this goes back to me to the problem of just how much data do you need before you go to the verification cycle? And this is a part of the problem with the accelerated timeframes that we're going to be under. Because in today's world, the Commerce Department wants to run what I call pre-verification. They want so much data coming in that they essentially reconcile everything to the company's financial statements before you even get to the verification stage. That's not what we used to do back in the 90s. But if you're going to ask for more information and more information ahead of time, that takes longer for the government to ask for it, for us to produce it, for the government to evaluate it. That's the driver why we've been extending out all these prelims and finals, because that time is required. The U.S. petitioners don't want us to have that anymore, which then makes you wonder about, well, is there going to be time to actually review the data and prepare it properly? The answer is questionable. On the last point, self-initiation. 1 minute, sorry. Yes, there are 1,000 questions. I mean, the last I could count on one hand the number of self-initiations. They're almost always, right, they're almost always trigger price mechanism. You violated it. That's a problem. Softwood lumber, okay, well, that's a problem. Self-initiate because you voided the agreement. You say we're not going to follow it anymore. How this is going to work, I have no idea. And there is going to have to be some standard applied because you have to have a basis upon which to bring a case. The question is, what evidence is going to be provided in support of that? Because the petitioners normally did it or do it. I don't know.
Okay, well, there's a lot more questions to be asked, but we have run out of time for this panel, so we're going to move on to the next. Please join me in thanking Matt and Mike for this presentation.